Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Thousands rally in Yemen against political and economic policies. Pakistan hospital hit by suicide bomber. And nonviolent resistance in Palestine. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
جرت تظاهرات في اليمن مطالبة بمكافحة الفقر.
Demonstrations were held in Yemen to demand an end to poverty and the oppression of political activists, especially in the south. Additional demonstrations were held in many cities in northern Yemen and were joined by opposition parties. These demonstrations support the demands of the southern movement, except for its demand for secession.
هتافة أشعلها الجوع.
These demonstrations were fueled by hunger. Perhaps the situation was exacerbated by the increase of government taxes on dozens of commodities, including some that are viewed by these people as basic. Thousands of Yemenis gathered in one of the most important sports stadiums in Sana'a, demanding that the government lower the price of goods and improve their living conditions. The demonstrators also called for a national dialogue in order to put an end to the repression of freedom of speech and the oppression of political activists, especially in the south. They also called for comprehensive political reforms.
Taking the country out of this dark tunnel can only be accomplished through an inclusive, comprehensive national dialogue. The objective of this dialogue must be to reach the greatest level of national consensus.
آلاف آخرون كانوا قد تظاهروا أمام مبنى محافظة تعز وسط البلاد.
Responding to the opposition party's call, thousands of others held a demonstration outside the province of Taz in the heart of the country. The demonstrators held posters supporting the demands of the southern movement for more freedoms and better living conditions, but did not show support for the movement's demand for secession. Southern Yemen's provinces of Al Dalia, Lahaj, and Abyan held a demonstration commemorating what they referred to as Prisoners' Day. Two protesters were slightly injured in Al Dalia, but there were no clashes in Abyan and Lahaj.
في أبيان ولحج. أحزاب المعارضة اليمنية أصدرت بياناً دعت فيه إلى رفع ما قالت إن.
Opposition parties released a statement calling for an end to what they referred to as militarization and the unofficial state of emergency. They also asked that the government fulfill their demands for the elimination of poverty, illiteracy, and corruption. The statements also called for denying an amendment to the Constitution that increases the powers of a dictatorship or undermines civil liberties, diversity, and peaceful transitions of power. The Yemeni authorities and political opposition parties exchanged accusations in regards to the derailment of an agreement that was signed last February that specifies the mechanisms for a comprehensive national dialogue. These developments came amidst warnings that the two sides will use the crisis in the country to settle scores between each other at the expense of the citizens' stability and security. Anwar Alanzi, BBC.
A suicide bomber blew himself up in Quetta, the capital city of Balochistan province in southwestern Pakistan, killing 11 people and wounding 35.
The suicide attacker detonated his explosive device at a gathering of visitors in a hospital. They were mourning a bank manager who was killed by unidentified individuals. Reports from the site indicate that gunfire broke out after the attack. Security forces quickly surrounded and cordoned off the area.
In another development, an assistant to former Pakistani President General Pervez Musharraf described the UN report on the assassination of former Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto as a pack of lies.
The UN report accused Pakistani security institutions under Musharraf's leadership of failing to take sufficient measures to protect Bhutto. The report also accused these institutions of creating obstacles during the investigation into assassination. Meanwhile, a spokesman for Pakistani President Asif Ali Zardari expressed his satisfaction with the UN report.
هنا تخلد الذكرى بنظير بوتو في موقع اغتيالها في روالبندي. لكن السؤال عن الجهة المسؤولة عن
Here at the site of her assassination in Rawalpindi, Benazir Bhutto is immortalized. But the question of who is responsible for her murder still looms. Neither the Pakistani government nor the UN report answer that question. This is the place where the incident took place on December 27, 2007. A 15-year-old suicide bomber detonated an explosive device in front of Bhutto's car while she was leaving a gathering comprised of her supporters. Gunfire broke out immediately afterwards.
وقبل أن تكتمل التحقيقات في وفاتها تعلن السلطات
Before the investigation into her murder was complete, the authorities announced that the Pakistani Taliban and Al-Qaeda leader Bhutala Masood were responsible for the incident. In the midst of the political tumult that followed, the Pakistani government requested the UN form a committee to investigate the matter. But today, some people were surprised that the UN took on the investigation and demanded their government conduct an investigation of its own and announce the full truth to the people.
هي في الأمر وتعلن الحقيقة كاملة أمام الشعب.
But this may affect the institutions that remain intact after governments and organizations had changed, namely the security forces, the intelligence, and the army. The UN report accused the Pakistani security and intelligence agencies of deliberately creating obstacles during the investigation and of failing to provide full protection for the former prime minister.
The
federal government lacked a full security plan to protect Madam Bhutto. Instead, the authorities deliberately disrupted it. It did not provide her with the same protection that was provided to the two former presidents who belonged to Musharraf's party. Madam Bhutto's assassination could have been avoided if the police in Rawalpindi took sufficient security precautions.
نتائج التحقيق الدولي.
The results of the UN investigation brought former President Pervez Musharraf back to the front pages of Pakistani newspapers. The media criticized Musharraf and accused him of being responsible for the assassination of the former Prime Minister and the leader of the Pakistan People's Party. Musharraf's assistant described the report as a pack of lies and denied that Musharraf had any responsibility. But there is another interpretation of the UN report.
What the UN has done is provide certain explanations. In some paragraphs, the report says that Musharraf's regime was deceitful during the investigation process when he announced to the world the culprits behind her assassination only 24 hours after the incident. This aroused suspicion that the regime was involved.
Armani Bhutto, a spokesman for current Pakistani President Asif Ali Zardari, expressed his satisfaction with the UN report, indicating that it disproves the People's Party's convictions that Musharraf and his allies were responsible for the assassination. He said that the report paves the way for conducting a security investigation and for taking possible punitive measures against the people involved in the incident.
The election in Sudan has begun the vote counting phase, which will last several days. The results will be announced this coming Tuesday. The officials who were appointed to conduct the counting process have begun to check the condition and the number of ballot boxes. Then they will begin counting the votes in the presence of a number of local and international monitors. It is predicted that the results will lead to another term for incumbent President Omar al-Bashir. Bashir is trying to gain legitimacy from the Sudanese people after the International Criminal Court issued a warrant for his arrest for war crimes and crimes against humanity committed in Darfur. A number of opposition party leaders boycotted the election, believing that it does not have any credibility. In Yemen, a spokesman for the Supreme Security Committee, which is assigned the implementation of the truce between the government and the Houthis, announced that Houthi rebels opened fire yesterday at a military airplane in northern Yemen, but failed to hit it, violating the ceasefire agreement. In another development, a retired officer and a policeman were killed in two explosions that took place 4 hours apart in the mountainous region of Sa'd, in eastern Yemen's Shabwa province, an Al-Qaeda safe haven.
قتل فلسطيني برصاص الجيش الإسرائيلي خلال اشتباكات وقعت صباح اليوم شرق مدينة.
According to Palestinian medical sources, Israeli occupation soldiers killed one Palestinian during clashes that took place this morning in eastern Gaza. Meanwhile, the ousted Palestinian government in Gaza executed two Palestinians who were convicted by a military court in Gaza of collaborating with Israel. Amnesty International condemned the execution, saying that the way the military court operated in Gaza did not meet legal standards. Since it took control of Gaza 3 years ago, this is the first time that Hamas carried out an execution sentence.
Here in the headquarters of Gaza's police, the ousted government executed two defendants who were convicted of collaborating with Israel, which is considered treason. This is the first execution to take place since Hamas took over Gaza. Human rights organizations criticized the way in which the military court operated in Gaza. However, these organizations did not confront the reality of the threats posed by the defendants' crimes had they gone unpunished.
We believe that the president of the Palestinian Authority is the only person that has the authority to approve a death sentence. The president did not approve this death sentence due to political divisions. I think that the government in Gaza has wrongfully granted itself this kind of authority.
We met with a relative of one of the defendants. He explained what happened on the last day before the death sentence was carried out.
My brother called. He asked me to bring his children. He said that he wanted to see me because he was granted a special visit. He said that he was going to be transferred to another prison. They immediately allowed us to enter the prison, and we spent half an hour with him. I asked the police officer to tell me if there was anything wrong. I informed him that I'm his brother. He told me that nothing was wrong, but that they did not have enough space here. He also told me that we may not be able to see him for a few weeks, but that afterwards we can visit him as usual. In the morning, my son had an exam. Then I learned that they were going to carry out my cousin's death sentence. He called me and told me that I have to be there before 9 a.m. As I was about to start the car, the police came and told us to retrieve the body.
According to a statement by the military court of the ousted government, the death sentences were carried out after several appeals failed to prove that the defendants were innocent. The statement also said that the defendants were granted all of their rights. Hanan al-Masri, Al-Arabiya, Gaza.
We open with the developing Holy Land scandal, where former Prime Minister Ehud Olmert was today officially named by police as the senior official who received bribes to advance the luxury housing project when he was mayor of Jerusalem. More in this report.
The Rishon LeZion Magistrates Court this afternoon lifted a gag order and allowed the publication of the fact that its former Prime Minister Ehud Olmert, who is the senior official suspected of bribery in the ongoing Holy Land project investigation. Olmert arrived home early this morning after cutting short his trip to Europe by one day due to speculation in the press pointing to him. He did not stop to talk to reporters waiting outside his house in the Mutza neighborhood of the capital. Olmert was mayor of the city at the time that the Holy Land development was approved. Police sources said that he'll be summoned for questioning within the next few days. He is also currently on trial for a series of corruption cases that forced him to leave the office of Prime Minister in 2009. Olmert's former aide and law firm partner, Uri Messer, has also been under arrest for almost 2 weeks, as are a host of other municipal and elected city officials. According to the investigators, the developers who built the Holy Land compound paid enormous bribes to the officials to approve the controversial project. The sums of money that allegedly passed hands are in the millions, paid out by the project owners who made a fortune in profits. Up to now, the most senior official under arrest is former Jerusalem Mayor Uri Lopoliansky, who was head of the city planning committee at the time. Lopoliansky is suspected of receiving bribes of 3 million shekels that went to his Yad Sara charity and to another charity managed by his son.
In the last 24 hours, the Israeli police have arrested the previous mayor of Jerusalem, Lopoliansky. He appeared before the courts in Rishon LeZion this evening, and he will in fact be detained for the next 5 days after the court decision will be made and will remain in jail as the investigation continues.
The suspect denies all the suspicions against him. He gave a full version about his deeds. He answered all the questions that he was asked, and he said and he insists about his innocence.
For years, Jerusalem residents suspected greedy motives behind the permit granted to the developers of the atypical towering project, widely considered an eyesore. Several other projects around the city are also likely to face police scrutiny in the near future, including Mamila, the YMCA, and Gilo.
وإلى الشأن الأمني، حيث داهمت قوة عسكرية خاصة معززة بالمروحيات عددا من المنازل في منطقة الجعارة التابعة لقضاء.
Keeping up with Iraq's security situation, a special military force backed by helicopters raided several homes in the area of Jara in the county of Madaan, southeast of Baghdad. Some of the residents said that the invading force arrested five people and verbally and physically assaulted women and children, using profanity and sectarian slurs. In addition, the perpetrators stole some jewelry and destroyed the home's furniture and contents.
I'm sick and I take medication. This is the medicine I'm taking.
Some of the perpetrators were wearing masks. We don't know who they were or which agency they work for. They stormed the home around 3 o'clock with a helicopter hovering over the house.
They detained my sons. God help us. They assaulted the women. One of my daughters-in-law was injured and was taken to the hospital. They beat us up. They also stole jewelry and cash. They took about 5 million Iraqi dinars.
I think they were Iraqi police. They stormed the house and started to beat us up. They lined us up next to the window and ordered us to raise our hands. Then, one by one, they pushed us into the water. They also insulted us.
They ordered me to raise my hands up. I was in the kitchen when they stormed the house. They started to beat us up. They searched us and then searched the house. They beat us up.
أودى انفجار عبوة لاصقة آسفة صباح اليوم بحياة.
Meanwhile, three Iraqi students were killed and another was seriously wounded in a sticky bomb explosion north of Bakuba. According to a security source in the Diyala province, 4 6-year-old students were on their way to school when they were hit with shrapnel from a sticky bomb that exploded east of Athem.
بانفجار عبوة ناسفة في الضواحي الشرقية لناحية العظيم. وفي إطار تنفيذ بنود الاتفاقية الأمنية التي
As part of the implementation of the security agreement, which calls for the transfer of security responsibilities to the Iraqi authorities, the Iraqi armed forces took control of the security of the area of Yusufiya south of Baghdad. The transfer of security took place at the ceremony inside the Yusufiya army base, which has been under control of the U.S. forces since 2003. Several U.S. and Iraqi security leaders attended the ceremony. Among the attendees was Samir al-Haddad, representative of the outgoing Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki. Al-Haddad promised that the area will be blessed with security and stability, which will be made possible by the Iraqi armed forces.
For nearly a year, the Iraqi army has been the leading force in providing security and protection in the area of Yusufiya. The Iraqi forces are carrying out all security duties, with only logistic and not military help from the U.S. Army. The Iraqi forces are capable of taking control of the area. They are capable of overseeing the security issue, as well as helping to maintain control in the area. This is yet further proof of the Iraqi army's capabilities.
وفي مؤتمره الصحفي الذي عقده السبت أكد السفير
Iran's ambassador to Baghdad Hassan Khazami Khomi reiterated that his country will not interfere in the formation of the new government in Iraq. However, he specified the factors that are necessary for the success of the government, implying that his country will play a major role in Iraq.
محمد الغزي
All the parties that won in the Iraqi general elections must substantially participate in the formation of the new government. This statement was made by Iran's ambassador to Baghdad, Hassan Qazimi Qumi. At the Iranian embassy in Baghdad, which was attacked by a booby-trap vehicle last week, the ambassador specified the factors that are necessary for a successful new government.
The Iraqi government must meet certain factors so it can be strong, independent, and nationalist. All political parties must participate in the formation of the new government. Technocrats must be members of this government as well. They must cooperate with each other to serve the public interest.
Qumi said that the Iraqi slate represents the Sunnis and that the new government will be diverse. He explained that his country will cooperate with all Iraqi groups and that Tehran will keep its doors open to everyone.
The Iraqi elections showed that each group voted for their own party. The Kurds voted for their party, the Shiites vote for their parties, and the Sunnis voted for the Iraqi slate, which has 80 Sunni candidates. This means that the Iraqi slate represents the Sunni Iraqis.
The Iranian ambassador reiterated that the Iraqi slate requested to visit Iran and that Tehran welcomes the visit. He added that Iraqi officials have been visiting a number of countries in the region, including Iran, which he believed is strengthening regional relations. However, the American embassy in Baghdad does not think that the Iranian position is justifiable. Rather, the United States wants the Iraqis to make their own political decisions. وداخل
أراضيهم. نحب إن القرار للرئيس وزراء.
We would like the Iraqis to make their own decision on their next prime minister. This decision should not come from America or abroad. According to the information that I received, Jay Gardner is not speaking on behalf of the American government. He represents himself.
Since the elections ended and did not lead to a decisive victory for any party, intensive work is needed to form a diverse government. Mohammed Al-Ghazi, As-Somariya.
A new Israeli military order calls for the expulsion of infiltrators from the West Bank. Who is an infiltrator? And why is Prime Minister Netanyahu afraid of peace activists?
Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
The Israeli government's recent announcement of Army Order No. 1650 was just the latest act of provocation in a series of calculated measures to derail any possible resumption of peace negotiations. Under this new draconian measure, anyone who doesn't have a permit to be in the West Bank is to be considered an infiltrator and subject to expulsion or risk up to 7 years in jail. Expulsions and deportations are not something new for the Israeli military administrative system, which was established in 1969. Shortly after the occupation of the West Bank, Gaza, and the Golan Heights in the 1967 Six-Day War. At the time, the Israeli military was given the legal power to expel infiltrators without trial for various unspecified security reasons. Two particular Palestinian communities will be impacted by Order No. 1650. Palestinians with Gaza residences and Palestinians with East Jerusalem residences, as well as foreign-born residents of the West Bank. But many Palestinian and Israeli experts believe that it's the foreigners living amongst Palestinians who are the real target of the Netanyahu government. Many believe that this is part of an ongoing Israeli effort to silence dissent and crack down on international solidarity members and activists who travel to Palestinian areas to support protests and rallies, often bringing with them the eyes of the outside world.
People in Gaza are starving, the conditions are really bad, and the siege here and the demonstrations, the global demonstrations as well as the demonstration here, is to raise awareness to say this must stop.
Now that Israel has almost completed its separation wall, it wants to build a wall of silence and control the flow of information and limit the presence of foreign-born eyewitnesses on the ground. The question is, why now? A white intifada has begun to take hold in the West Bank and East Jerusalem. Every Thursday and Friday, Palestinian peace activists accompanied by members of the Israeli Peace Now movement and B'Tselem, as well as international supporters, gather to demonstrate against what they term as Israel's apartheid wall and land and home confiscations in the villages of Bil'in, Na'aleen, and the Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood of East Jerusalem.
نحن باين نشتغل زيتين بارد شلانو.
2 months ago, I witnessed a Friday demonstration in Sheikh Jarrah, where settlers tried to provoke peaceful demonstrators by harassing and spitting on them, while Israeli police and border patrol units watched from across the street. I was impressed by the demonstrators' calm and unfazed demeanor. Similarly, at the villages of Bil'in and Na'lin, peaceful demonstrators have been brutally beaten and arrested by the Israeli army. Nevertheless, more keep coming every single week. In February, a Czech volunteer with the International Solidarity Movement was taken in the night from her house in Ramallah and deported by Israeli forces. This new order will give a blanket legal cover to the Israeli police and army to instantly deport foreign activists and aid workers spotted at demonstrations. Last December, at another demonstration I covered at Erez, at the Gaza-Israel crossing, Israeli police did not engage the peaceful demonstrators who gathered calling for an end of the siege on Gaza. Instead, policemen were busy videotaping those who showed up, especially foreign nationals. Interestingly enough, my Israeli press card was indefinitely delayed for renewal after my coverage of that story. But that's another subject on its own. For years, I've been hearing the popular question usually posed by Americans. Where is the Palestinian Gandhi? During the past 2 trips that I've made to the Palestinian territories and Israel, I think that I discovered him or her in the eyes of the many peaceful demonstrators against the Israeli occupation. Non-violent resistance could be the biggest threat to Israel's ability to justify its continued military aggression and occupation of Palestinian lands. Order number 1650 is to neutralize the movement by deporting Gandhi. I'm Jamal Dejani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report.
To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/me. Stay up to date on the Middle East. Follow Jamal at twitter.com/JamalDejani. The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.